Hi folks, it's Pastor Nettie, and happy Sunday to you. I'm so glad that you're here to worship with us at Fredonia First United Methodist Church. You'll notice that I am outside. I'm actually in my yard, sitting by my tree. I was mowing my lawn and I was looking at the row of trees and I thought to myself, I bet you Jesus sat at a tree just like that and taught his disciples all about God and all about himself. So I thought I would do a spur of the moment lesson with you today and worship with you outside. So as we move into worship, let's bow our heads together and pray. Father, we thank you for your beautiful outdoors. We thank you for all the green around us that makes us feel relaxed and at peace. We thank you for a beautiful day and for the birds chirping in the background and for the little rabbit that just hopped by my stand. Thank you, Father, for our friends and our families. We thank you for those who have continued to work on the front lines to keep us safe. Today, Father, we lift up those who are not well, who might be in the hospital, who might have lost loved ones, who may be sick themselves, who may be isolated. Lord, we lift them all up to you for those who are lonely. And Lord, we lift up our governmental officials and our church officials, Lord, and we pray that you would give them wisdom and guidance as they take our country into a direction. Lord, that it would be a right direction, that it would be your direction, and that we would all be kept safe. So Father, today as we're all sitting on our couches together, thanking you for all that is good, I'd like us to share in the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us himself. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. I thought of that song when I was riding around on my motorcycle. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. That's a true song, because once you know Jesus, once you really meet Jesus, and once he chooses you to be a part of his kingdom family, and you say yes, there is no turning back, because our lives become so full and so complete. Does it mean we won't have troubles? No. But does it mean that we have God with us, and we have church family and community and friends, and that we have God's blessing? Yes. Does it mean that we can be a blessing to others? Yes. So, I'd like to talk a little bit about what a disciple is. So, before Jesus came, if you are new to church, I just want to give you a little background. Everything in the Bible before Jesus came is considered the Old Testament. All the stories in the Old Testament lead up to the New Testament. The New Testament would be from the time Jesus was born until the time, well, I guess until he comes again for his church. So those movies you saw, like the Ten Commandments and all those movies you watched around Easter time, those were Old Testament movies taking us to the time of the coming Messiah, Jesus. And that would start the New Testament. Jesus born, new chapter in life. As a matter of fact, time was kind of laid out that way, if you'll notice, before Christ and after Christ, because it was such a paramount occasion that happened when Jesus Christ was born and came on the scene. So what happened in the Old Testament was people would follow teachers and become disciples of teachers, and they would learn the way that God wanted them to behave. God laid out the law so that people would understand how to behave and what good looked like. What did love look like? It was more of an outward action or behavior. What happened when Jesus came? Well, the temple was destroyed, number one. So instead of all going to meet in the temple to learn and to grow, these little churches or synagogues started to pop up in communities, kind of like we have in our churches. And people would go there and they would worship and they would learn about God. They would learn about Jesus. So Jesus was a teacher. Not only do I love Jesus because he's my Savior, meaning he saved my soul, which means I'll go to heaven when I die, because now my life is eternal and in his presence. Not only do I love Jesus as Lord of my life, I actually consider him in all my decisions and I wait for his guidance to take me in a direction, but I love the teachings of Jesus. If you look at the teachings of Jesus, they are all about how to love and respect one another, all about community, all about taking care of one another, loving God first and loving your neighbor. He even teaches the disciples how to handle conflict, how to move through conflict, how to navigate forgiveness. There's just so much, so many wonderful things that Jesus has taught all of humanity, and that's another reason I really love to follow Jesus. I believe in his teachings, and I believe he was the Messiah that they wrote about in the Old Testament. All those stories that were waiting for the guy to show up on the scene who would be the Messiah. Well, I think there were over 300, and all 300 came true, proving in Jesus that Jesus truly was the Messiah, the true Son of God. How miraculous is that? But what I want to talk a little bit more about is as I was riding around on my lawnmower, I was thinking about it. Even on my lawnmower, I'm a disciple. Even on my lawnmower, whether I'm on a walk, whether I'm doing my dishes, whether I'm driving in my car, I am fully always aware that I am a follower of Jesus Christ. It's not just something I do on Sunday morning for 1 hour. And believe me, I've had times in my life where I have followed other people and places and things and gotten lost. I was lost for quite a while. But Jesus, you know, I think about when he called the disciples, when he called Peter and he called some of the disciples, he called them. And Peter, he was out on a fishing boat, literally on a fishing boat, had been up all night fishing. Jesus calls him. Peter says, "Yes, Lord," drops his nets and literally leaves his occupation behind. That's a disciple. And he wasn't just a disciple on that day. He literally had a life-transforming change. And see, that's another thing. In the Old Testament, it was about outward behavior. Jesus was all about inward change, a transformation of the heart. You know, God told Israel that he would break through their stony hearts, and he would move into their hearts, and he would write their law on the people's hearts so that they knew who he was, and they knew how to love not only God, but one another. So disciples, that's one of his mosquitoes. Disciples were disciples all the time. They weren't just disciples on Sunday morning. And if we really want our world to change, then we need to decide as people who know God to love God and follow God and his ways every day and all day, so that we can be catalysts of change. Because really, that's what the disciples were. When Jesus returned to heaven to be with our Father, the disciples took over. He passed the baton. And then it was the disciples who had spent 3 years learning with Jesus, who shared what they knew, who shared what they knew, who shared what they knew, so that I could sit here and you could sit there and you could know what it means to be a follower of Christ. There was a prayer that Jesus shared with the disciples before he was going to be crucified on the cross. I'd like to share that with you. There's a lot in it. It's a little bit long, but I want you to listen to it, because it was the prayer that Jesus not only had for his disciples then, it's the prayer that Jesus has for his disciples now. Because people, it is so important that we choose to follow Jesus in our own lifetime. We can carry on the movement that started with Jesus and was passed to the disciples and then passed to the next generation of disciples and the next. We can be that generation of disciples that teaches the world around us about the transforming love of Jesus Christ. And I know a lot of you, and a lot of you already know who God is, and you know who Jesus is, and you are really gifted and talented people, and right now is your call. God is calling you like he called the disciples. He's saying, come, follow me. Learn my way of love. Learn the way to my path. Teach it to those around you. So I'd like to read this to you. It's taken from the book of John. I'm going to move a little closer. John 17. This is just before Jesus is going to be crucified on the cross. Jesus says, and this is all in red letters. If you open up a Bible and you see red letters, you'll know that the red letters is everything that Jesus said. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now, this is eternal life, that they know you. You hear that, friends? Eternal life is knowing God, and it starts the minute you say, yes, you want to follow Jesus, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. I have brought your glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words that you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. Glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one just as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by the name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that the scriptures would be fulfilled. Jesus said, I'm coming to you now, but I say these things while I'm still in the world, so that they may have a full measure of my joy within them. You hear that, friends? To hear the reason he came, so that we would have a full measure of his joy. He didn't come to condemn us and to punish us. No, Jesus came to love us, to reconcile us to God. It's good news, friends. Jesus says, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them. Sanctify them by the truth being your word. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too might be sanctified, set apart, made holy, made pure, emptied out, made clean, so the Spirit could fill us. Jesus prays for future believers. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one, just as we are one. I in them, you in me, so that they might be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be here with me where I am. I want them to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. O righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. Friends, when you start to really learn about who Jesus is and what he teaches, you're going to learn that it is the greatest message of love that you've ever known. You know, when I grew up and we went to church, no offense to any church, we mostly learned fear. And we thought God was fear. And it's true that some people need to be afraid or feared or fear the Lord to come to repentance. But really, Jesus came in love to build love community and a kingdom of love. We have nothing to be afraid of in Jesus Christ. So, I am this generation of disciples. And I am being prompted by God to invite you to be one of his disciples, one of his followers, to be intentional about looking at Scripture and learning who Jesus is, what he really taught, not just what you think he taught, but what he really taught. Because it'll be life-changing, life-transforming. One last thought. There was a scripture in the New Testament. I told you the Old Testament was more about outward behavior. The New Testament, Jesus' message, was more about inward heart transformation. He said in one of the scriptures, and I don't know it off the top of my head, he was calling them to account and he said, listen, he said, adultery is a sin, but even looking at a woman with lust in your heart is a sin. See, he went from outward to inward. He also told them that to hold every thought captive and that we would be accountable for every word we've spoken. That scares me a little bit. But you can see just in that, that Jesus is calling not just for outward behavior. He's calling for inward change. You know, nowadays we're seeing some things go on around us in the news. We're seeing the law be changed, a law put in place, because there are some people who naturally do not respect humanity. So many of us don't need a law to respect humanity because it's written on our hearts. It's written on our hearts. But for some, the law is needed because they are not doing by nature what God is calling them to do, or being, or treating people the way they should. I guess I'll end there. Lord, I just pray that each one of us will hear your call today. I pray that each person sitting in their couch or on their chair or on their outside patio will answer the call to follow you, that they will decide to follow your son Jesus and get to know him more and learn from Jesus the law of love that you would so much like to write on our hearts. I just lift us all up to you, and I thank you and I praise you in the name of your son, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Happy Sunday, folks. See you next week. Thank you.
Hi folks, Pastor Nettie here. Just wanted to touch base with you and let you know once again that if you are in need of anything, that we are here for you. Please don't hesitate to call the office. The phone number is in our directory. It's also on our webpage, as well as my own personal cell phone number. We are happy to be of help to anybody who needs it. Also, if you are a Fredonia person, one of our FFUMC people, and you are able to continue to send in your pledge, that is so helpful right now as we are trying to keep some of our staff on to help with checking in on families. We're buying food cards to make sure people have what they need. So if you are able to continue to support our ministry, that would be very helpful to us right now. And we hope to all be together again soon. Thank you.